Hello friends, welcome to Pioneer of Success, an online free educational institute. So today we'll be continuing with the chemistry series, and today's topic of discussion is UV and visible spectroscopy. Before starting the presentation, I would like to thank Rupam Sinha, one of my colleagues here at IIT Guwahati. Rupam Sinha has made this presentation and has kindly given me the permission to make a video on this presentation, and so I'm very much thankful to him. So let us start the presentation. So this presentation will be consisting of the following topics. So first we'll talk about electromagnetic spectrum. What is electromagnetic spectrum? How many wavelengths are there and everything about it. And then we'll talk about absorption spectrum. Then we'll throw some light on electronic energy level and transition. Then obviously we'll come to the selection rule. So the selection rule is something which you have to know. And in any kind of spectroscopy you study, you have some selection rule, and this is very much important, because if the selection rule follows, then only then you will have transition from a particular energy level to another energy level, and thereby the spectrum. So then we'll be talking about effect of substituents and conjugation on absorption spectra, then principle of UV and visible spectrum of photometer. And then obviously we'll talk something about instrumentation and some examples and so on. So those are the electromagnetic spectrum that consisting of X-ray, UV, visible, IR and microwave. You can see here, then X-ray has lower wavelength compared to the microwave. So when we go from left to right, we are basically increasing the wavelength and thereby decreasing the energy. So in terms of energy, X-ray has much energy, more energy compared to these microwaves. And so X-ray is very much harmful because it has more energy, and so it has more penetrating power. It can damage your tissues and all. So you should be careful while handling with X-ray. So here we'll be working on this domain, this UV and visible domain. And that is, if I tell you the visible domain, it starts from 400 nanometer and it goes up to 700 nanometer, and anything below 400 nanometer and above 200 nanometer is UV. And this spectroscopy, this UV and visible spectroscopy basically works on this domain of spectrum. So we are interested from 200 to 700 nanometer for the time being. So those are the types of radiation I have already talked about: X-ray, UV visible, IR, microwave, and the type of transitions, and those are inner electron, outer electron, molecular vibration, molecular rotation. So because of all these phenomena, you can have transition, and whenever there is a transition, there should be some change of level of energy, and when electron again comes to the lower energy state, and then it gives a spectrum. So UV and visible is basically absorption spectroscopy. Now what do we mean by absorption spectroscopy? So basically there are few molecules which are active. Now if we throw some light or some electromagnetic radiation on top of this molecule, then what happens? Then these molecules have some tendency to absorb some sort of light, and that absorption you can measure by change of intensity, and we'll talk about it in the instrumentation part. So basically what you have to know, you have some molecules and you have some electromagnetic radiation, and you are bombarding the electromagnetic radiation on top of the molecules, and then there is some interaction goes on between the molecules and the electromagnetic radiation, and the absorption which is happening there you can quantify by some law, and that is VR Lambert law. We'll be talking about in the later part of this presentation. Now as far as this UV and visible spectroscopy is concerned, there are two terminologies very much important, and those are HOMO and LUMO. And those are molecular orbitals, and HOMO means highest occupied molecular orbital, and LUMO means lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. And basically electron transits from this HOMO to LUMO, and so what happens when you give some sort of radiation, this radiation has some energy, then this energy excites the electron that is residing in HOMO, and then it goes to the LUMO after absorbing the energy, and again the electron comes back, and that is why you are getting spectra. So we'll continue. So here we have an animation. So this is the electron residing. I'll tell you. Yeah, this is the electron residing in the ground state, and when we bombard radiation here, some electromagnetic radiation, in this case either UV or visible, then what happens, then this electron actually goes from, yeah, this is the energy we are bombarding with. So after absorbing the energy, the electron goes from lower energy ground state to excited state. I'll show you the animation once again. So we are bombarding with energy, and the electron goes from lower to the higher energy state. Now this excited state is not stable, so what happens when you remove the light, then again the electron has a tendency to come back to the ground state. But when it comes back to the ground state, it would obviously emit energy, and that energy will come as a spectra, and that is all about this UV and visible spectroscopy. And this is the energy level, the difference of energy, and that is being quantified by h nu. So now we'll be talking about electronic energy level and transition. So this is the molecular orbital picture. So what is molecular orbital? You know, the atomic orbitals combine to form molecular orbitals, and after forming the molecular orbitals, there are various energy states. So one thing you have to understand, when atomic orbitals combine and it forms molecular orbital, then the energy level goes up and down. What does it mean? It means some of the orbitals acquire lower energy levels, and some of the orbitals acquire higher level energy level, but overall energy of the system remains constant. That is the main thing of molecular orbital theory. So here, this is the non-bonding orbital state, that is the energy state of the atomic orbitals, and those are the orbitals which is getting lower energy states compared to the atomic orbitals, and those are sigma and pi, and those are the antibonding, and it is getting higher energy state compared to the atomic orbitals. Now transitions can be possible from any of the lower energy states to the higher energy state. So I'll tell you. So all these transitions are possible. So those are the unoccupied orbitals, and those are the orbitals having electrons. Now electron can go from this lower energy states to the higher energy states, and all these combinations may be possible. Why am I telling you may be possible? I'll come to later, because all the transitions are not possible. There are some selection rules. It should abide by the selection rules, and then only you'll have the transition, and then you will have the spectra. So here I have talked about something energy state. So sigma to sigma star has the highest energy state, because you can see sigma is at the bottom and sigma star is at the top, so it has the maximum energy barrier. And then you have n to sigma star, pi n to pi star. So you can see here n to sigma star, this is the energy barrier. I'll show you. This is n, this is sigma star, this is the energy barrier. Then pi to pi star, this is the energy barrier. Pi to sigma star, this is the energy barrier. So all these transitions may be possible if it is obeys the selection rule. Yeah, now I have given some examples, like where exactly sigma to sigma star transition is possible. So you know sigma bonds are everywhere in a molecule. If this is single bond, this is a sigma bond. So in alkenes, sigma to sigma star is possible.